everyone. We are delighted to welcome you to Seeing Differently, Musical Interpretations of Artworks. Our festival, Sound Frames, is conceived around the intersection of music and the visual arts. Can sound reveal a new way of perceiving? Would our interpretation of a visual artwork change with sound? We thought it might be exciting to explore that interplay through the artworks in our collection. But before that, I would like to introduce you to a newly created sonic identity for MAP. As a young museum, we have been working hard to build the MAP identity. What are we about? What do we stand for as an institution? The team finally arrived at the concept of an accessible, inclusive museum that would be a space not just for objects, but for ideas and conversations with the community that we initiate through our collection. But then, what would MAP the museum sound like? And that's when the idea of a sonic identity emerged, and we collaborated with Brand Music to create one for MAP. Brand Music has worked on what they call a MOGO, or a musical logo, that defines the institution in terms of sound. So we're really excited to be presenting today the MAP MOGO and the MOGOscape, or a sound palette that we can use across multiple scenarios, whether it's our events, programming, videos, education packs, and a whole range of things. In this program, we will attempt to unpack the process of how we arrived at this sonic identity for MAP with the people who created it. Our two guests from Brand Music, Rajiv Raja and Deepak Marwa. Rajiv Raja created the concept of the MOGO and conceived Brand Music along with the late J.S. Money. He brings on board more than 25 years of experience in branding on one hand and music on the other, because he was the creative head of an advertising agency, and he's also one of India's finest jazz and fusion flautists. Deepak Marwa is a management graduate from IIM Calcutta who has spent over 3 decades in business, brand, and retail. And he has used that rich experience in brand building and marketing. So this combination of talents helps Brand Music merge brand understanding, consumer insight, and musical expression to create a unique way of reaching out to consumers and audiences. So let's jump right in and talk about what a sonic identity is all about and why is it useful or relevant to have. Rajiv, do you want to talk about that?
Hi, Kamini. Great to be here.
Good to have you.
Along with Deepak and all your colleagues. So why is a sonic identity important? I guess today brands are looking for another dimension that can be added to their identity. And traditionally, most brands use the logo or the visual identity. And our journey really started where we said, can we add a sonic dimension, not just to the logo, but to the overall identity of a brand? And I'll hand it over to Deepak to say a few more things about why, in this day and age, a sonic identity is critical for brands. Deepak?
Thanks, Rajiv. Thanks, Kamini. So why is a sonic identity important, especially today? You know, this today, it's becoming an increasingly audio first or audio led world because of the explosion of digital and the explosion of, or the, you know, the amount of mobile phones which are available now. Everybody has a mobile phone and now slowly graduating to smartphones. This has exploded really the places or the number of places that you can hear a brand. So while a visual identity has always been consistent across touch points, there are today multiple audio touch points, or what we call ear points, where a consumer experiences a brand or consumes a brand. And therefore, you know, whether it is digital content or television or radio or social media or podcasts or influencers or smart speakers, it just can go on and on and on, the number of places that you can hear a brand. So it is a huge opportunity for brands to have a consistent brand asset, which is a sonic identity, which works in a consistent manner to project the brand values and the brand personality across these touch points. And hence the need we feel for a sonic identity, and that we, which is consistent across hear points. And that is what really, why we need, we feel that there is a need for a brand to have a sonic identity. Raji will tell you more about the process later, but that is really the background of why a sonic identity is important today.
Yeah, it's interesting for you to say that, because when we commissioned research by an organization called Ririti, because we wanted to understand what people want and expect of their museum, and they were speaking to audiences across a whole range, they found that people of all the art forms, people most responded and liked and said they liked music. So I think the sonic identity is also for a way for institutions and organizations to be reaching out to their audiences in ways that seem to connect with them.
I'd like to add that, you know, today consumers are looking for experiences in this world. They are looking for experiences, and there is multi-sensorial ways to really reach consumers through different senses, and MAP would know it much better than anybody else, being a museum. And therefore, while that is the visual arts or sculpture or paintings, but then there's another dimension, and there is obviously the visual element, which is important. But there are different ways. Sound is a very critical sensorial way which reaches deeper and creates an emotional connect and stays longer than many other senses.
So that's a whole journey, actually, of all the senses. Yes. But I think it would be good for both of you to actually talk us through the process of how you arrived at the MAP Mogo. Because I remember we went through these several sessions of brainstorming between the two teams, where we first explored the attributes of the MAP identity. And I remember telling you all that, so all of us kept saying, what are the attributes? And we said, maybe we want to be innovative, we want to be experimental, we wanted to reflect a sense of discovery, of heritage, and yet playful and joyous. So there were all these demands that we had. So I think it would be nice for you to share how you arrived at the MAP Mogo and that whole process of creation.
Raji, would you like to take us through the three stages?
Yeah.
And then...
Sure. Yeah, so Kamini, as you were saying, that was the big challenge, right?
Yeah.
That when we deal with brands, there are so many things to say. Now, how do you filter it down to some of the key, most important things? And therefore, while we do talk about the attributes of the brand and the emotions, etc., we use a very, very simple process. The first stage is something we call brand discovery, which is really us discovering your brand, but discovering it in very simple terms, very vivid human terms, right? So it's not just descriptors, because, you know, most brands would like to be innovative. Most brands would like to be contemporary, et cetera, et cetera. So then they become a sort of a cliche, right? It becomes difficult to get to the nub of what the brand is all about. So our first stage is really just visualizing the brand as if it were a human being. Now, in all our lives, we know that there are different personalities of people amongst our friends, family. You would say one person is, hey, he's an entertainer, right? The minute he comes into the room, he makes everybody laugh. Or you would say another family friend. She's so caring. You know, her nature is essentially caring. And you would say a third kind of person, he's a leadership kind of guy. You know, he's a ruler. He's going to be a big leader one day. So there are all these character types, and brands, we believe, fall into those kind of character types. So that's the first visualization of what kind of human being would the brand be if it were personified. The second aspect we look for is what emotion does the brand want to evoke? And, you know, in our Indian culture, the entire theory of rasas for artistic expression, cutting across any kind of artistic expression, be it dance, be it drama, be it the visual arts, be it music, the theory of rasas, which essentially is what the artist does to evoke certain feelings in the audience. So if you apply the same principles to a brand, we say, what are the kind of feelings that your brand wants to evoke, right? And therefore, we then get to the heart of MAP. And we say, okay, the kind of feelings you want to evoke is certainly a sense of aesthetics, Shringara. But there's also happiness, you know, the joy of discovering new pieces of art. There is happiness, there is hasya. There is also a sense of adbhuta or wonder, saying, wow, I never saw it like this, or something that really surprises you. But beneath it all, there is a democratization that MAP stands for, of art and of the artistic experience. And that also comes in with an underlying feeling of shanta, which is peacefulness overall, right? So it's we had to juggle with a lot of these things, but in all things artistic, there, after all the logic, there must come the magic, right? So I will invite Yash, just come on. And Rajiv, Deepak, you want to add anything? Yeah, sure.
I'd like to add, along with the rasas, as Rajiv talked about, is the personality, or the avatars, as we call them.
Absolutely.
And when we looked at what MAP stands for, what is the personality, through the various rounds of discussions, many times very heated. You know,
I wouldn't say heated, passionate.
Yeah. I like that word better.
So yeah. We finally honed on to two avatars, which we felt described MAP's personality best. One was a sense of explorer, you know, exploration, that there is a journey, you know, when you go through the different pieces of art and how you travel through the museum and you keep discovering new and new pieces. So there is a sense of exploration. And second is a certain sense of magician, a certain sense of magic, magic in the sense of transformation. Wow, you know, I didn't imagine this place would be like this. I didn't imagine I would see some artwork like that. It transforms you. It transforms your feelings. And therefore, along with the rasas, which Rajiv talked about, which was Shringara, Hasya, Adbhuta, and Shanta, are the two avatars of magician and explorer. So that was the key on the basis of which I think Rajiv will talk more now.
Yeah, absolutely. Thanks, Deepak. So, you know, but beneath it all is a sort of purpose that we got out of the entire brand discovery session, which is the greater purpose of MAP, which is, you know, to spread the experience of art, to be inclusive. And it's really, as I said, the democratization of art in a sense. So, all of this and really the whole conversation, this is Yash. As you can see, he's behind his instrument and he's composed the Mogo and the Mogoscape. So when we were chatting, one of the things we said was, you know, yes, magical. The whole feeling has to be magical. As we discussed, there's so many elements and so many rasas, but really the trigger, I think, was the explorer, right? So an explorer is always moving. It's a constant journey. It's, you know, meandering. It keeps going on. But at the same time, there is a sort of relentlessness, to the movement. So that's really the inspiration for the Mogo, or the melodic structure that we came upon. Yash, will you just play us the first part of the melody? Yeah. So did you hear that? Just simple ta ra 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 ra. And then we said, okay, that is a little linear in the sense, could we have a sawal jawab? That is, could we have to that question, which is ta ra 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 ta ra 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 ta ra 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 ta, could we have an answer? And the answer is, okay, so you've got a question which is ta ra 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 ra, and you've got an answer which is ta ra 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 ra. It's a resolution, right? So this was the basic construct of the Mogo scape, and we went into another section, which was what we call the bridge. Right? So the whole theory of composition is that you have repetition, but then you have surprise, where the repetition leads into something unexpected to the ears, and that is called the bridge section. And Yash, can you just play the bridge section? Coming back to
absolutely journey, surprise, inspiration.
Yeah, absolutely. So, I guess a lot of people ask, but did you feed this into a computer and like work out all the elements? So many percentage of of this rasa and so many people know. The thing is, at the end, it's all alchemy. You get the whole thing picture in your head and the composition happens, which is why we shared so many possibilities with you. And I think all of you all like this particular piece. And there it is, the new Mogo and Mogoscape for MAP.
Lovely. So I think let's play it for our audiences. Let's first play the Mogoscape, which is a wider palette.
Yes.
The Mogo that is derived from the Mogoscape. Yeah?
Absolutely. That is the Mogo.
Okay, so lovely to have presented the Mogo and the Mogoscape, which we are really premiering at the festival. So as we discussed the Mogo and the Mogoscape, the conversation naturally led to the idea of the relationship between the sound and the visual. You usually look at a painting, but what if you were to listen to a painting? Why not encourage people to use one of the senses that they do not usually employ when they approach the visual arts, the sense of sound? And so together with Brand Music, we worked on a sonic interpretation of six artworks that represent the six different categories of the MAP collection. Sights and Sounds, the exhibition premieres at the festival, and we are going to walk you through the show and the process of its making. Each of the artworks that you are going to see evoke a mix of emotions that could be joy, fear, or melancholy. And how does that change your experience of the work? Deepak or Rajiv, would you like to add something to that before we start the walkthrough of the works?
I'll just talk. In fact, it was really, really exciting when we first saw the six different pieces of art, which were varied. And what we do is when we were asked to do a sonic interpretation of the six artworks, what we said is really how we approach, just what when we talked about the Mogoscape and the Mogo, we approach it through the theory of rasas. What is the emotion which is evoked through that piece of art? What is it trying to say? What is our interpretation of that? So we go back, because that is the basis, the emotions, the theory of rasas. What are the rasas which each artwork is trying to connote? And therefore, for each artwork, we agreed on and came to the rasas which we felt were being evoked in that particular piece of art. And of course, we will take you through each one as we go through each individual artwork and what were the rasas in each case. And Raji will talk about it and the inspiration for each one.
Okay. So let's begin with a work from our modern and contemporary section by one of India's finest modernists, Ram Kumar. While his early works were figurative, towards the late 60s, the figure gradually recedes, giving way to abstract landscapes. So this painting is from 1976, a time when Ram Kumar had moved completely to abstraction. What's really striking about this work is his use of color, hues of red to create mood and emotion. There's a raw intensity to this painting. You almost feel these bursts of flames emerging that then gradually settle into burning embers, all expressed through strokes of paint. Rajiv?
Yeah, so for us, it was fascinating to, you know, just gaze upon the painting and look to the muse for inspiration. But as you said, you know, this painting was a sort of mixture of two opposing elements, really. One was very visceral and the other was very ethereal, you know. So there were the rasas of bhaya, there was fear, there was karuna, or, you know, compassion bordering on melancholy. There was raudra, which is anger coming through. And there was also, as I said, a final ascension into the sublime, which evoked a sense of shanta. So the composition really went through all these, you know, stages. Because I guess the theory is you have to go through conflict and hard times for something beautiful to emerge. And that is really what the composition tried to bring across. But we just use very, very organic sound, just two flutes, almost in a conflicting battle with each other. Ah. And that really was the whole idea between of our musical response to this amazing work of art.
So the instruments are mainly the flute.
It's just the flute. There's nothing else. It's just two flutes of different pitches. One is a lower pitch and one is a slightly higher pitch, and it's these two flutes sort of battling to reach nirvana.
Okay, let's listen. I'm
And yeah, don't miss the Mogo right at the end, the map Mogo.
Yeah, after this combination of emotions like fear, compassion, anger, I mean, we're now moving to an object that's completely different.
Yeah.
This shadow puppet of Anjaneya or Hanuman, that is a testament to the long-standing tradition of storytelling in India. Shadow puppetry originated in the 2nd century BC during the rule of the Chalukyas in South India. It is an ancient form of storytelling and entertainment, popular in many cultures, particularly in South and Southeast Asia. In India, traditional forms of shadow puppetry are largely found in Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, Kerala, Tamil Nadu, as well as in Maharashtra and Orissa. The narratives based on mythologies like the Ramayana, the Ravana Katha, the Mahabharata, are depicted through these puppets. And heroic characters like Ram, Sita, and Hanuman are often worshipped before being used as a puppet. Rajiv.
Yeah, so this was, again, an interesting combination because when you think of Hanuman, you immediately think of Veera. You think of courage, certainly. The form of shadow puppetry, as you mentioned, has a sense of playfulness, has a sense of surprise, and a very folk kind of feeling. So that was our inspiration for the music, a very folk form with very playful sense of Adbhuta built in, but you will also clearly hear a transition into Veera, which is really the, you know, personification of Hanuman. And use of traditional instruments really sort of brings that all alive with a very upbeat kind of tempo.
Yeah. A lot of children are going to have fun with this.
Yeah.
Okay. So from a puppet, we move to a Balachari sari from our textile collection. As you can guess, it comes from Baluchar in West Bengal that produces another variety of brocade in India. It would take 2 weavers almost a week to produce one sari. Traditionally, these would depict scenes from the epics like the Ramayana and the Mahabharata again. And you see many architectural influences in Baluchari. You now had scenes from the lives of the Nawab of Bengal featuring women smoking hookahs, Nawabs driving horse carriages, and even European officers of the East India Company. Now, the pallu of the sari depicts individuals riding in a steam engine. So these are really scenes drawn from everyday life. And what was changing in their lives and what the weavers saw was changing. At the top, we see what appears to be a European man and a woman along with the operator, while the bottom shows two men perhaps smoking pipes or engaged in conversation. So let's see what Rajiv and Deepak have made of this one.
Yeah, this was again very inspiring because when you look at the intricacy of the work of the weave, what really came to mind was the intricate plucking of a guitar, right? So that formed the basic theme. We also had the sound of the loom actually form the music track, the rhythm track, which we also cleverly processed to give a feeling of train's wheels going over the tracks. So using the sound of the loom in the rhythm of a train's wheel going over the tracks, also sort of a nod to the European sitting inside the railway carriage. And all of this, of course, we weaved in our mogo into that. And therefore, very, very traditional Indian art, but with European elements also in it. And that was what the composition was all about. There was a traditional Indian sound, but at the same time, also European sound built in. So that was Baluchari.
I think all the elements that you've infused there, we are able to pick up, you know.
Wonderful, yeah. Love it, yeah.
Yeah, the wheels on the tracks, all of that, yeah. And that mixture of the traditional music with the influences, the European influences.
Yeah? Yes, yes, yeah.
Okay, so we are into the next section. So what you're seeing on your screens really is a semi-automated portable display unit, which is part of our collection of popular culture. The arrival of the printing process in the 1800s allowed for images to be mass-produced and so available to the common man. This portable unit, based on an artwork by R.G. Chonkar, contains a print depicting Holi. So we see Krishna in a green and yellow dhoti, along with gopis dressed in colorful saris set against a palatial backdrop. The colors on the ground, the golden pitchkaris or water guns, and the coy look of a seated gopi all add to this sense of celebration. A turnkey mechanism at the back of the unit brings the print to life. Some of the figures have their heads and hands cut out and then pasted onto the print to allow for visible movement. Once it is wound up, you notice the subtle nodding of heads and the slight motion of the hands and the pitchkaris. So Rajiv, would you like to tell us all the sense of fun that and celebration that you've brought into this work?
Yeah, we've all sort of grown up with the sounds of Holi. So that inspiration wasn't very difficult to find. But there is a particular rag called Rag Bheem Palasi, which is traditionally associated with Holi. Uh-huh. So we use that as the building blocks to create the entire piece of music. While the rasas, there was a sense of hasya, which is the joyfulness, the playfulness. But there's also Shringara, which is a romantic mood, of course, with Krishna and the gopis, definitely. So again, it was, while Hasya is very active, Shringara is passive. And there's a certain coyness also, as you mentioned. So how do we bring out all these elements, really balance these two active-passive kind of feelings together in sort of traditional holy kind of celebration. So that really was the inspiration for the music.
Okay, so let's listen to this one now. A sense of fun about that. Okay, from Holi we move to quite a different artwork. And to our photography collection. So this image was taken by Prabhudha Das Gupta, a renowned photographer, who throughout his career took on a variety of projects, both commercial and artistic. His photographs seek the personal and the intimate, capturing familial relationships, personal spaces and time. He worked mainly in black and white because the monochrome palette, as he put it, suited his minimalist approach and allowed him to capture the essence of the subject. This photograph is from his Edge of Faith series, a set of 79 black and white photographs, which capture intimate portraits of the Catholic community in Goa. There's a sense of longing, tenderness, and I would say mystery in the photograph. We know their names, but the relationship that they share, what they mean to each other, is left to our imagination. Rajiv.
Yeah, so again, conflicting emotions here, lot of depth, lot of possibilities for interpretation, definitely a sense of karuna or compassion. There's also a sense of shringara, a deep bond between these two, and an, you know, overwhelming feeling of peace, but mixed with, as you said, longing, bittersweet, I would say. You know, that's what sort of came to us. And when we looked at this, and then we also looked at the Goan connection, what really came to mind was the whole sense of the blues. And so we used a very simple blues harp or blues mouth organ and an acoustic guitar to really capture this whole feeling. We used a typical blues format with a little bit of a difference where we weaved in the Mogo also of MAP. So have a listen. The blues. We actually, in our internal circle, we call them the Blues Brothers.
Okay, let's listen to the blues. Talk about a depth in terms of emotions. You can also see that technically in this photograph because there's this depth of field as well. You
exactly.
can see from this room into the next and then into the distance, which is all a mild blur. It's quite a wonderful photograph.
Amazing, really beautiful, absolutely beautiful.
And beautifully done with sound as well. Okay. So from the blues to this sculpture of Brahmani, from our pre-modern section, that dates back to possibly the 10th century from southern Karnataka. She is related to the god Brahma, and they share many of the same attributes. Like Brahma, Brahmani has four heads, but we only see three in this sculpture. She holds a rosary or akshamala and a water pot or komandalu in her upper hands. Her lower right hand is an Abhaya Mudra, or the gesture of protection and reassurance. Her lower left hand has possibly a lotus pod and is held in the gesture of generosity, or Varada Mudra. Brahmani belongs to a group of seven or sometimes eight goddesses known as the Matrikas, or mothers. They are not mothers in the conventional sense, and there are many stories about their origins. One of the most common is how they came into being to help the supreme goddess Devi in her fight against the demons Shumba and Nishumba. Rajiv, why don't you take over now?
Yeah, so apparently Lord Brahma has a favorite rag, and that rag is called Vachaspati. And we took inspiration from that rag. And being from Karnataka, obviously the feeling of the music had got to be Carnatic. And in terms of the rasas, there was Shringara, but not in a romantic sense, more in a devotional sense of, you know, absolute devotion. There was also a sense of courage, you know, arising from Lord Brahma. And of course, a female voice rendering the entire piece as a tribute to Brahmani. So that was really the mix. And again, kept it very simple. And you'll hear it. I think it just evokes all that devotion and that feeling towards this wonderful piece of sculpture.
Such a sense of peace and calm, and yet this exquisite sculpture with all the adornments that go to make female beauty.
So. Absolutely, yeah. Very, very spiritual feeling.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, this brings us to the end of our walkthrough of the exhibition. But we do have a wonderful surprise for you that will bring this session to an end in the most fitting way, with music. So Rajiv is going to tell you a little more about that surprise, but thank you so much for being with us. I hope you enjoyed this program.
Thank you, Kamini. This is Deepak, me, the entire team at Brand Music, signing off with a little gift, surprise we've created for y'all. We believe that music must transcend beyond being, you know, merely an identity for your brand, but also be an experience for anybody who is interacting with your brand, and therefore represent all the values that MAP stands for, which is spontaneity, creativity, expression, etc. So we've taken the liberty of taking the Mogoscape and actually calling in musicians and creating a live jam session with improvisation, spontaneous stuff, which is a sort of longer, almost maybe it could become part of your first MAP album. Oh,
Thank you.